very unusual. This is something we've never done before, and probably won't ever do it again. No, it came with the idea of, I've never done an unplugged. You know, I've done solo piano shows, but never done an unplugged before. And I mentioned it to the lads, they thought it would be a bit of fun. And I thought it would be really nice to do it with two pianos. So I grabbed Oliver, who's been absolutely brilliant. Unfortunately, Oliver knows the stuff better than I do, which is a bit of a shame. I'll introduce you to three of the guys who are going to start us off. First of all, great guitarist, been with me now for 11 years, and he is absolutely fantastic. Mr. Dave Colquhoun, real top man. Top man, not his playing, his clothes. But you can sit here if you like. That's for you, yeah. See how together we are, can't you? My great, dear friend, he's a political correctness. His name's Tony Fernandes. We've been together since 1975, and I can only call him by what he calls himself, which is he's from Italian extraction, and he lovingly calls himself the Greasy Wop. Deliberately lacking the full kin of it, because this really is a genuine unplugged with nothing plugged in. And there's only a tiny bit of your kit there, isn't there, really?
And no sticks.
And I don't use around, that's even louder, that's terrible. And finally, this is quite interesting, my oldest boy, Oliver, who's come up from, he lives near Cheltenham, and today, we thought that his lovely wife, Lisa, was going to have their second baby. And it was really funny because I spoke to him yesterday and I said, well, and he said, well, it could come. I said, well, this is going to be the real proof as to whether you're a professional musician. I said, because you either say to Lisa, keep calm, keep them crossed, and I'll be back as soon as the show's over. So would you please welcome dad-to-be Oliver Wagan. Possible you could be at the granary.
You have to book gigs more than 9 months in advance.
No comment to that one. Okay, we're going to do most of the stuff that we're going to do hums.
Yes.
Most of the stuff we're going to do is stuff that we don't normally do. There'll be a few surprises and they all have stories. But we're just going to do a little warm-up piece, which is a piece we don't play with the band. Sometimes I do it with on the piano show, but not very often. And it's a piece I wrote for a circus called Cirque. Surreal, which there was a band that played, which my other son Adam ran the band. You played it. You weren't in the band for that, were you, Oliver?
No.
And you weren't, were you, Dave? And I wasn't. So we'll be following you then. You don't know the piano. Okay. So this is, we do hope you enjoy tonight. There'll be a few silly stories in this. This is called The Jig.
Thank you.
that there's...
It's working. Oh, he's now. You probably gathered that there's one person missing. And this is one of my dearest, oldest friends. We first met 1966, when I was still a schoolboy and I joined the top-ranked ballroom at Watford. A 17-piece soul band doing all the Wilson Pickett and Otis Redding stuff. And the singer just knocked me out. I just thought it was absolutely amazing. He's not here tonight, but we've been there. No, the singer, he was absolutely amazing. We became great friends. Would you please welcome the original Fat Man of Pop, Mr. Ashley Holt.
Do you remember when my mum first met you?
You freaked my mum out. You did. It was, 1966?
Yeah.
You had hair down your back, you had all these trendy clothes. I only had my school uniform.
I have to say, I thought she was rather rude.
Well, you came around there, I stopped at the door, she answered it, and then came to me and she said, there's a thing at the door. She said, I think it's for you. But you got your own back. If you remember right, my mum was off to Keep Fit. She used to go to Keep Fit classes. And she had this green sort of short skirt on. And you said, your mum's funny, she's got her legs on upside down. But you got on great, didn't you, in the end?
We were fine.
Absolutely. Yeah. Now, we've done lots of things together. This is a piece of music that we don't do with the band, which we recorded on an album, the King Arthur album. Now, the King Arthur album was interesting because I wanted to do a follow-up to Journey to the Centre of the Earth. And back then, there weren't hundreds of charts like there are today. There was the English chart, album chart, and there was two in America, which was Cashbox and Billboard, and it was the top 100 of album charts. And I noticed, looking at the charts in the Billboard magazine, that every title had a line. So it would be Dark Side of the Moon, Pink Floyd, whatever, it was done like that. And I thought, if I had a title long enough, I'm getting two lines, and then it will really stand out. So we called the album The Myths and Legends of King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table. Remember that? And it went straight at number three in the American charts, and they just called it Arthur.
So I felt no fear.
The exciting bit where Dave tunes up.
I thought that was shorter than I actually am. Right, well, apparently I'm doing a solo spot. And here it is. So I'm going to play a couple of things. The first one, this is an instrumental guitar piece called the Grand National. And it uses odd tuning, that's why it took me so long to tune up. Sing for you on my next piece. You've got that, so enjoy it while you can. Okay, the Grand National. Thank you. Introduce you to my other guitar. This is quite an unusual one, this one. And you're the first people to see it played in public. It's quite unusual because the strings are upside down. But it's not left-handed. It's actually tuned for a right-handed person, which is me. So I wrote this song. I write songs for people. This is one that was actually I wrote with a guy called Little Florian Army, and it was pitched for Kylie Minogue, but she's not here, so I'm going to sing it. But without the gold hot pants. So this is it's actually a song, it's been used on my wife's one of the original Bucks Fizz members, Jay Aston, not one of the two blokes, or Cheryl Baker, for those who don't know. And it's actually gone on their album, and it's called This Day Is Mine, and I'm going to sing it for you now. This day is mine. I own this moment in time.
his shirt, isn't it?
Yeah, eh?
Still doing the lumberjack job, are you? The tree fell in. Excellent, that. That's about right. I mentioned earlier that Oliver is, it's absolutely true, at least for his lovely wife. It's literally is due any second, isn't it?
Yes.
And,
now we're good.
Yeah. He was actually born, I was in 1972, I was out on tour with Yes, and I got the message that he'd been born, and you were huge, weren't you? £10 something.
Yeah,
£10. Born in two beds in the hospital, I think you were. And I got the message through, and it was literally about 10 minutes before we were due to go on stage. And it's the only time I've ever gone on stage seriously the worse for wear. Because I was suddenly thrust a bottle of champagne, it was probably that American champagne, which is really grim, and a few brandies and a few beers, which I downed in about 10 minutes, and went on and felt quite ill. And we used to run the roundabout, and I played it appallingly. I think I did the solo in a completely different key to everybody else. And John Anderson at the end said, "It's all right, he's just had his first boy, Oliver." And the place went absolutely nuts, and they forgave me for everything I did. So I told them you were born for the next 46 gigs. I thought that would cheer you up. But if you'd like to tell everybody what you're going to play, that would be wonderful.
Well, seeing as she's at home cursing me for being here, probably, I thought I'd play a piece for my wife. It's just a piece called LJW. Thank you.
interval in a minute. It's called prostate. Well, for most of us anyway. But what we're going to do, this is something, again, this is a piece that we've never, ever done, any of us really before. Last time I played this piece in anger was 1962. And I was 13. And I formed a little trad jazz band at school. I was a huge trad jazz freak, loved it. And I formed this little trad jazz band, and we had a lad who played the trumpet badly. My cousin played clarinet very well. I did piano. We had a guy called Edward Fisk who played the drums. Well, I say drum, he had a drum, a snare drum. And he couldn't keep time at all. So you'll have no problem with this one. And the funny thing, we had a young lad, I can't remember his funny name, who used to sing. We didn't have any amplification or anything like that. So he had one of those megaphone things. You know those things you sing through.
Yeah.
You got one?
I've got some. I made it today.
What's the handle bit? The last time I saw one of those, it had a battery. It's like a rabbit written on the side. That sounds rubbish. That's rubbish. Well, this piece of music, we used to...
Other way round.
That's it. So this little piece, we used to do all the old trad jazz, right? And we thought we'd do this for a bit of fun to finish off the first half. And it normally starts with the drummer giving it plenty of weight, normally starts with the drummer giving it just something like that. And it's called Sweet Georgia Breath. Thank you. And this was back in 1977, it would have been. 76, 77, something like that. And I was in California, I was in San Francisco, and I had a great friend out there called Ron Drinkard, his name was. That was his name, and that's what I used to do. And it was quite good. He was a lovely fellow. He was a diver for the government. And he used to dive down on old wrecks and all that kind of thing, and where they'd been when the boats had sunk or whatever. And I remember this is about 1976, 77. And he used to have to take film footage down there. Now this was the days, not like the great technology they've got today. And it was literally like Super 8 camera that was underwater in these special sort of containers. So it was pretty difficult to do what he did. And I went round his house, round there for dinner one night. And he said, I've got something to show you, you might like. He said, I was doing some film footage of this boat. He was actually doing the footage to try and find out why it had sunk. And all around this boat, he said, you just watch what happens. And you could see, the water was really clear. You could see the hull and the damage of various things. And then from literally inside this hull came out all these seahorses. And it was absolutely fantastic. These seahorses all came up. And it lasted, the film was about 4 minutes long. And then they all eventually went back in again. And I said, show me that again. And so he put it on, and he had an upright piano in the room in his house. And I sat at the piano, and I played along with it. And got an idea that I just really liked. Very simple, because the whole thing about the seahorses, they just move up, and it's all just on one level, on one plane. And I played along with it for about 4 minutes, and then we did it one more time. I grabbed a piece of paper, made a few notes and various things, and that's how the song was born, which, amazingly enough, is called Seahorses. Here we go. So if you're going to close your eyes and imagine seahorses or whatever, you can do it. And if you don't,